Hello, everybody, and welcome back. I am Brian Donahue. I'm a senior security specialist on the community team at Red Canary. I think this is like the eighth overall video in our Defender for Endpoint educational series, where we're kind of looking at analytical features in that tool. I know that it's the second installment in our sort of LSASS trilogy, where I went on my VM and I did some sort of nefarious monkey business with LSASS, where I took an elevated PowerShell script and I took an elevated PowerShell prompt. I ran a script that used run DLL to dump the contents of LSASS into a dump file, right? So I put a bunch of credential material in a dump file. I did this on a VM that's instrumented with Defender for Endpoint. And in the last last installment of this video series, my colleague Joe Savini, he's a principal solution specialist here at Red Canary. He went through Defender for Endpoint, looked at all the alerts that were created by it, told you kind of what mattered in there, and talked about triaging and investigating those alerts. So today, sort of like following the pattern of the previous videos in this series, Joe Savini is going to go from those alerts, and he's going to jump into sort of some of the response actions that you can take in response to or in the attempt to remediate a threat like the one that we emulated with that Atomic Red Team test. So without wasting any more time, I'm going to hand things off to my colleague, Joe Savini.
Thanks, Brian. So in front of us right now, we have Defender for Endpoint open, and you know, we have the mess here that Brian created for us that we've already triaged initially. We've gone through, we found out that he was doing some really suspicious stuff with PowerShell, and it looked like he was actually trying to grab LSASS, and you know, by the looks of it, he may have been successful here. And so when we talk about response in context of a fileless attack, we have to think about it a little bit differently than we do for a binary attack. And so when we zoom in, we see EDR as a detection source. That means, in fact, that these alerts were discovered behaviorally. Well, behaviorally, when you're using things like binaries that exist natively within Windows, you're not going to be able to have the same exact approach that you would normally have. Typically, you might be able to, for a signature-based threat, go ahead and action on a specific file to cause it to be blocked throughout your environment or to stop that process. But here, we're talking about PowerShell. We're talking about a single instance of PowerShell. So we can't exactly just stop PowerShell from running, especially if it's already executed. It doesn't make sense. And we can't block PowerShell from running in our environment. I mean, we could, but that'd be pretty drastic. And there's a very major operational impact that could have, right? So PowerShell being a core component of Windows and being used by a lot of legitimate stuff, we can't just action on PowerShell. So what are our other options for response? Well, you know, we might think to ourselves, we have this desktop itself. So could we initiate some sort of response at a device level? And I think, you know, that could be something we could try. So we see here, we could open the device page. We have a device isolation option. We could restrict app execution on that device more specifically if we think, you know, hey, we don't want anything other than some core Windows applications executing on that machine. But I think in this case, it could be possible that the attackers have already stolen our bacon. And, you know, it might not make sense for us to isolate that device, or it might not have a great impact in this whole attack lifecycle to begin with. So let's go ahead and see if we can validate that. And one of the ways we're going to do that is we're going to hop into live response. So you can see here, we've actually initiated a live response connection to that machine. And based on the command line parameters, we know that this memory dump was going to the C Windows temp directory. And inside C Windows temp, we're just going to have a look down here until we find, hey, there it is. We found it. So LSASS is there. It looks like it's approximately 61 megabytes, which, you know, that's a large file for an attacker to have to action, but they could potentially work on that exfiltration. And if they do run Mimikatz against that, they could extract some credentials. There's other methods that they could use to extract credentials from that, but there could be a broader impact of them actually extracting those credentials. So I think when we think about response in general, your response to this threat is going to vary based on your company's incident response procedures. So whether that involves the greater investigation of other machines that have been compromised through hunting, or working with your incident response provider to get their best advice on a response for a specific BIOS threat like this. In this case, it's generally probably going to be part of a larger incident. So that's going to require a more coordinated response effort. Now, what we can do is talk more directly to mitigation, because while this attack did occur and Brian was successful this time, we want to make sure that he's not going to be successful next time if he goes ahead and tries to do any of this sneaky credential dumping stuff. So inside a Defender, you know, typically you were going to err on the side of availability for these types of attacks. And we see here that these specific types of attacks are categorized as suspicious activities. Suspicious activities are not the same as malicious activities, which are something that is definitely defined as bad. If something is definitely defined as bad, like we know for a fact it's absolutely bad stuff, Defender is going to block it by default. But with these suspicious activities, we can't just go around blocking them. But if we've made the decision organizationally that we're like, hey, you know, it's kind of above our threshold of risk to just allow process dumping in our environment in general, because this is not something that we expect to see. Maybe we don't have developers or we don't have other people who are going to be initiating this type of activity. So we could develop a baseline. There's actually a whole process for that. So Microsoft has the concept of attack surface reduction rules. So if you fall into that category, this is just the standard Microsoft documentation on docs.microsoft.com. But if you fall into that category of organization where you feel like, you know, you want to take that to the next level and you want to be able to do a little bit more with Defender for Endpoint, you can get more deeply into the policy and the modification options by enabling attack surface reduction. Now, these aren't directly accessible from the Defender for Endpoint interface. You're going to need to be managing your devices some other way, whether that's group policy, SCCM, endpoint manager, that sort of thing. Now, you have this list of attack surface reduction rules. Specifically, Brian was going after the credentials. So we're going to look for LSASS. And sure enough, there is a attack surface reduction rule that applies specifically for LSASS. So that's really, really cool for us. So let's have a basic look at how you would enable that sort of thing in Endpoint Manager to prevent this from occurring in the future. So if we jump over here to Microsoft Endpoint Manager, this is actually a separate console from Defender for Endpoint, but it's tightly tied at the hip, you could say, because a lot of the endpoint security options for Microsoft Defender are managed right directly here. And that includes like your AV options that are going to be for your signature-based stuff. But we also have this attack surface reduction, which is going to enable us to create a baseline policy here and actually prevent Brian from doing his dirty work here. So we're going to go ahead and create a policy for attack surface reduction rules. We're just going to call it test policy because this is indeed just a test. And we'll dive into the configuration settings. And sure enough, we can actually see all of them. And right up here, right near the top, hey, they knew that it was going to be something they were interested in. We can actually block credential stealing from the Windows LSASS process. So there's a couple of different options here in terms of what you can do, whether or not you want to audit for this first as part of some type of security baseline you're trying to establish, or you actually just want to go ahead and just block that. So if we enable that and next, and you know, save this policy and ensure that policy is deployed to our machines that have Defender for Endpoint, this is going to be a great way to ensure that if those attacks are trying to be executed in the future, that you know, we're going to go ahead and stop them. There's a couple other different types of mitigations that we can enable as well. One of those is known as Windows Credential Guard. Now, Credential Guard is in a deeper part of the operating system, and it's actually not, the policies for Credential Guard currently don't reside in Endpoint Manager either. Those have to be done explicitly via group policy or through the registry. So it's a little more advanced to go modifying those policies. But as Brian mentioned, you know, we're considering production of a video series that goes into some much deeper Windows administration concepts in GPOs and enabling a lot of that stuff to give you the best security result possible. So hope this has been informative when it comes to response actions for fileless. As you can see, and as Brian mentioned, it does vary based on the type of threat, right? That's the value really here to these video series is that, you know, when we're responding to a file-based malware or something else, it makes it a lot easier to just go in there and terminate that process or try to remove that threat. But when you start dealing with things that could be involved in a larger incident or something more broad or something more tightly integrated with the operating system, there's just a couple, there's some subtle nuances to how you would address that. And we hope this has been informative for you.
All right. Thanks once again, Joe. The attack surface reduction controls you were just showing kind of piqued my interest a bit because we published a blog like a few weeks ago or maybe a month ago. I should say, well, we Red Canary published it. Our colleague Matt Graber actually wrote it, but he was going through some of the attack surface reduction controls as it relates to, I believe it was called the Defender driver block rules. Yeah. The Windows driver block rules in Defender for Endpoint. And, basically showed how you can pretty simply go through and block the execution of like all known malicious or suspicious drivers in your environment. You can use a stock list that Microsoft has that has like kind of a bunch of drivers that have been known to be used maliciously in the past. You can add your own drivers if you think you need to as well. Anyway, that's a total sidebar. I recommend Googling it and going and reading it. It was a really interesting article. However, like that is all we have for today, running through the response actions here. So I hope you guys found this useful. In the next installment of this video series, we are going to get into some of the stuff that you can do in the Defender for Endpoint Advanced Hunting Console. And then finally, we're gonna once again pivot from there into Red Canary because Red Canary streams telemetry out of Defender for Endpoint into our own engine. We apply our own rules to it. So we'll walk through kind of that added defense in depth you can get and sort of the extra benefits you get of sort of leveraging Red Canary on top of Defender for Endpoint. So thanks again. I hope you guys found this useful.